Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father of us and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today we will talk about the masks that we wear. No, not these masks, but these masks, saint and sinner. In ancient Roman mythology, Janus was the two-faced god. He was the god of beginnings and endings, of gates and transitions, of doorways and passages, usually depicted as having two faces because he looks in two directions, to the future and to the past. And that's why these masks are sometimes called Janus masks, the mask of comedy and tragedy. The mask of Melpomene is the muse of song and celebration. How strange that she should hold the mask of grief, for it is her mask that is worn along with the tall boots of the tragedian, the noble hero who stands high, but who falls low from joy into suffering because of a fatal flaw in their character. The mask of Thalia, the muse of joy and grace. Her mask is worn by the humble comic actor who wears the low sandals, who is shorter in stature to reveal their low estate, in whom, in spite of their flaws, are raised from suffering into joy, in part because they themselves show themselves worthy of love, and often because when they have the opportunity to do the wrong thing, they instead do the right thing, even if in that moment it doesn't work to their advantage to do so. As the audience, we want to see the hero in the story do the right thing. We rejoice when the comic hero is redeemed at the end of their story. We weep for the tragic hero when at the end of their story they are excluded from the happiness that they might otherwise have enjoyed. Together, these masks represent the divine drama, the portrait of the highs and the lows of life in this world, active storytelling through the art of imitation, holding up a metaphorical mirror to the culture through which we might reflect upon the reality of our own lives. And this is why Jesus teaches us using parables. So when the chief priests and the Pharisees heard these parables, they perceived that he was speaking about them. And although they were seeking to arrest him, they feared the crowds because they, the crowds, held him to be a prophet. This is not a parable about tenant farmers. It looks like one at first, but it goes off the rails pretty quickly. It's obvious that this story is really about something else. Jesus has cast the chief priests and the Pharisees along with them into the role of tragic heroes. Yes, they are tenant farmers who believe that the master of their estate is never going to return to his property. That's their fatal flaw. They believe that if the landowner then dies without an heir, then the land would default into their possession. I submit that the tenant farmers are actually noble characters. Look, they are granted stewardship over a land that is not theirs, over livestock that is not theirs, over fields and fruits that are not their own, to live in a home and to work with tools and equipment that are not theirs. They have been given great responsibility and high status by the landowner. They are, yes, his servants, but noble servants, vassals. There is privilege and honor in this great commission that they hold. It's reason to rejoice and to sing and celebrate and dance, to wear the mask of Melpomene, to stand up tall and proud. But they are not special on their own. They are only special because the landowner has given this trust to them. The source of their nobility is found in the landowner, not in themselves. So perhaps that's part of what Jesus is trying to get the Pharisees and the chief priests to see, that this parable is such a thinly veiled exposé of the chief leaders of Israel, their motives, that I wonder why Jesus even bothers framing it as a parable, really, unless there's so much more to this than simply revealing that, like the shadow.
Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of men? The shadow knows.
Certainly, Jesus knows what they are up to. He knows that they are plotting to kill him, just like their forefathers killed the prophets before him. And he's telling them that he is the heir to his father's estate. He is here to call them to repentance, to, in a sense, give up their fruits. He's the Messiah, the rock of their salvation. And this is his fate, the fate that he must come to. And yet they will either break upon this rock or they will be crushed under it. This is the divine drama. Certainly Jesus will die a tragic death, the son of the landowner murdered by tenant farmers who covet his inheritance. The grim news is that they'll not profit from it. It'll be taken from them and given to others who are more deserving. That's how the story will conclude, with a wretched ending and being stripped of all honor. But for the author of life, the story doesn't end in the grave. The gospel story is, of course, high comedy in the classical sense of that word, where the humbled hero is raised up to anthems of joy. But where is that story included here? This is a tragic tale, and I would ask you to think about the reasons that we tell tragic stories to begin with. Why do we tell them? What is the purpose? Tragic stories teach hard lessons. Tragic stories allow us to suffer vicariously along with the hero, to learn the same lesson as the hero without suffering the same fate. The tragic story provides us an opportunity, a second chance, which the tragic hero will not have. So there's purpose. Who is Jesus telling the story to? Everybody? Well, yes, but especially to the chief priests and the Pharisees. People that we tend to think of as the bad guys, not the heroes. We make a mistake if we do this. A tragic story is a story that tells of a noble hero who falls from grace. Look, when a villain in a story loses, we rejoice because justice is being done and all is right with the world. But when a hero suffers and dies through the action of their own vices, then we are humbled, because there, but for the grace of God, go we. Tragic tales are cautionary tales. They are intended to encourage us to make better choices, intended to let us learn hard lessons without having to suffer those consequences personally. As we watch the chief priests and the Pharisees become the bad guys and suffer the wicked end intended for wicked people, we should shudder. For if we do not watch ourselves, we could find ourselves in the same pit right along with them rather easily. So what are we to do about it? Do we need to do anything about it? Maybe this cautionary tale just doesn't apply for you. Or maybe it does. Probably it does. In 1977, Billy Joe charted the Billboard Top 100 with The Stranger. You remember the song? We all have a face that we hide away.
to try them on.
If you've ever stood in front of the mirror and wondered just who that was staring back at you, then you'll understand the lyrics to this song. If you've ever asked yourself, who am I? You'll relate to the different faces that we put on. Faces like, I've got it all together face. Or the angry face that says, keep your distance. Or the indifferent face that says, I don't really care and you can't make me. All those masks that we use to hide behind so that we don't have to show who we really are. Sinners in need of a Savior. And that's one of the reasons when we gather for worship that we begin by taking off the mask, metaphorically. I, a poor, miserable sinner, do confess to thee all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserve your temporal and eternal consequences, but I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them and pray, right, for forgiveness. That's the unique work of the church, to receive that forgiveness. So we take the mask off. You're looking for joy? Begin by counting your blessings. Oh, I know it sounds trite, but it's true. In order to foster an attitude of gratitude, it helps to remind yourself of the gifts that God has given you. Now, as I studied this text this week, I looked to try to find the joy in it, the gospel, the comic twist of grace and mercy. Where is it to be found? Look at the faces. It's hard to see them when they hide behind masks. But the tenant farmers, and then for by extension the chief priests and the teachers of the law, they wear a tragic mask with downturned faces. But why should they? They are stewards of a great estate, nobles, heroes. I don't understand what they think that they're going to gain as becoming owners of the estate, at least certainly by deception or murder. Except I suppose that they could keep the surplus for themselves instead of paying the profits to the landowner. But apart from that, I don't really seem to see what they have to gain by their rebellion. They live on the land. They live in the house. They work in the vineyard. They have authority over their own lives and their own labor. So what improves about their lives exactly if they took over ownership? I can't think of one thing that they would gain. But I can think of one thing that they would lose. They would no longer have to be accountable to the landowner. They would no longer have to be accountable to God. So where is the joy in the text? I know where it should be. It should be in their vocation as stewards of the mysteries of God. For whatever reason, they are not finding satisfaction in their stewardship, in their servanthood, in the land, in the house, in the vineyard. Somehow all of that is just not enough. And so we're grieved to see them for what they are, mean-spirited, unappreciative thugs, undeserving of their status as servants in a great house. So you want to find happiness? Well, happiness is found in the pursuit of outcomes. Example, in order to be happy, I need X. And when I manage to get X, then I will finally be happy. We will be happy when we win. We will be happy when we get our way. It's all an outcome. Joy is different. Joy comes from being who you were created to be and from doing what you were made to do. In that sense, joy is a constant. If you're walking around wearing this mask, then you are accepting the role of the fallen hero, and you will not be doing what you were created to do. When you ask yourself if you're setting the right goals or choosing the wrong things. Knowing who you are is hard. So maybe begin with who you are not. This is not who I am. Well, maybe it is, but this is not who I am going to be. This is not what God wants for me, who God made you to be. You want to experience joy? Then start with that. Or go back to that. That's what repentance is, after all. That is the comic story, where God raises up the lowly and wipes away the tears. And the proud are downcast in their conceit, but the lowly he has lifted up. That's the Magnificat. That's the song of celebration. That is the ballad of the Mother of God, the Church. That's our song. And that's good news. It's the comic mask of failure. It's grace. Amen.